is John Cullough with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my backyard garden here in June. And it's already June, and check it out. The thermometer, 100 degrees today, and it's going to be 100 degrees for the next couple days, maybe the next week, and maybe just from here on out we might get a few days in the 90s. But even in May we had 100 degree days. Anyways, in this short format video, I know a lot of you guys will appreciate and some of you guys won't, I just want to go over actually the reason why I don't start the majority of my plants from seed in the garden with one very important example. So actually, let's head over to this side of my garden to show you guys the plant that I want to tell you guys. So just wanted to take a moment out of this episode today to remind you guys that we're still doing, for a limited time, the Growing Your Greens T-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens T-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens T-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below. CompassionTees.com. Link is also at the end of this video. So when you're done watching the video, click over and support me while you still can, and also get a cool organic t-shirt at the same time. So the example I want to give you guys today is of my Malabar spinach plant, and actually why I don't direct seed Malabar spinach into my garden. And I got some very good reasons. But basically, you know, in this video I hope not to let you guys know not to ever direct seed anything in your garden, because there are plenty of crops that I direct seed in my garden, and I'll show you guys a little bit later actually what crops I do direct seed. But also there's many crops that should not be direct seeded in your garden, or you will not have success, right? Super critical, super important. You know, I've learned these things just by doing it and experiencing it and trying to direct seed things in my garden, let nature take its course, have it sprout up at the right time of year. And it just never seems to work if I leave it to nature to sprout and germinate at the right time when the temperature is right for the seed, because of, you know, I'm not growing the Malabar spinach where it is meant to be grown, probably in Southeast Asia somewhere, right? I'm growing in a climate that gets cold part of the year, and it just needs to have a little bit warmer temperatures to germinate properly. So that's why for my Malabar spinach, actually I plant into my garden from transplants that actually I've been babying in the greenhouse for at least a month or more, and then they go into my flood table for even a bit longer before they even go in the ground. And you know, the result of that is, look, I mean, I'm here in June, and these Malabar spinaches are now, you know, the vines are taller than me. They're towering over me, over 6 feet tall, and they're just winding and creeping. The leaves are now at a point that are now edible and ready to eat. And if I just direct seed it in my garden, I would barely have anything to eat. And as you guys saw, the temperature's already dipping in the hundreds. You know, it makes it a little bit more challenging for little baby plants that just aren't quite established to get full size and to be, you know, resilient and stable in the ground before, you know, the big stress of the heat comes on. So actually, let me show you guys actually a seedling that actually started itself about at the same time I put my transplants into the ground that were already about a foot or a foot and a half. All right, so along this wall here is where I actually grew the Malabar spinach last year. And you know, I did collect some seeds, and I do have some seeds still available at growingyourgreens.ecwid.com. But honestly, as much as I collect seeds, I let a lot of the seeds just drop in place to see what's gonna happen, to see if they're actually gonna come up. So if we kind of look to these, you know, Malabar spinach plants that I actually transplanted, at the bottom here, actually, let's see, there's a whole bunch coming up at the bottom when I planted these guys next to it. I'm like, oh, this will be interesting to make a video or show. And like a lot of the little seedlings that were coming up like over here are no longer here. And that's number one, because of the little roly-poly bugs. I don't know if you guys can see them down there. But those guys love to eat baby plants. Yes, they eat more than decaying organic matter. But anyways, some of the plants did make it. Here's a little seedling here, and this seedling sprouted and came up and was growing the same time I put in this transplant that was already maybe a foot, foot and a half. And it just, I mean, look, it's like mostly gotten eaten. The leaves are still coming out a little bit. All right, so here's some more actually that have been growing that have been doing a little bit better, maybe not getting eaten as much. But they're about 2 inches tall now. They maybe got 4 leaves on it.
And the thing about the Malabar spinach is that they grow really, 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 really slow, man, until they get at least a foot or foot and a half tall. Then they start growing like gangbusters, man. But getting them to a foot and a half tall, that could take quite a bit of time. You know, maybe even a month or two to get them that first 1 to 1.5 feet, because they grow really slow until they're busting out. So yeah, so if I just planted them by seed and let nature sprout them and germinate them when the weather got warm, they would still be small, and we'd be in 100 degree weather and they'd still be small, and then they would just really wouldn't perform, you know, during the summer for me.
So that's why for these plants, you know, I transplanted them from transplants that are already a foot and a half tall, and look at them now. So what you guys are looking at now is my flood table. Basically floods once a day, it gets actually nice sun, and this is where, after I put my plants in the greenhouse on a heat mat with LED lights that only went on the daytime, as not to let the police know anything's weird, because they were that red funky hue. I don't particularly care for those too much, they attract unneeded attention, but the plants seem to like it. But I have an Instagram, so check my Instagram always to see what I'm doing and posting on Instagram. I try to post a picture a day on Instagram. And anyways, back in March, you know, I had my Malabar spinach that were like super baby tiny, still in 6-packs. And then they grew for a while and got bigger. Once they got bigger, then I put them into 4-inchers like this, and they went into my flood table. And look, this is actually one of the plants that just still hasn't really been growing that well. You know, there's always going to be a runt of the litter, and there's always going to be a runt plant that just never really does as well. So this is still sitting in my flood table for it to get even taller, right? This is a foot. I don't really like to plant them out when they're this tall yet. They're still not quite developed. I want to get them a little bit taller, a little bit more bushier, and then plant them out so they'll have an easier time growing. All right, so here's another plant that's been sitting in the flood table, and look how long this guy is. I mean, he goes up and then he goes down. So this guy is ready to get planted out. Yeah, so he's really nice and long, you guys can see. And you know, I like to plant these guys out because once these guys go in the garden, they're nice and established. They got a really good root system in there that's already going to be seeking out the water, and it's going to basically thrive in the hot summer, whereas a little seedling, it just wouldn't be big enough at that point to survive. So while I did put in transplants for my Malabar spinach, there's many other crops that I put in my garden and started from transplants. These cherry tomatoes that are now pushing 4 or 5 feet tall were put in from basically 6-pack plants that I like buried the stem big way, and now they're super tall, growing super lush, and I'm gonna have lots of nice standard cherry tomatoes growing. And you know, I would encourage you guys, whenever possible, especially on some of the warm season crops, to put in transplants and grow them in a greenhouse, or whether you're buying your transplants like most of mine are bought, you know, I think you're going to have a lot higher level of success. And now I always want to caution you guys, because like transplants aren't always the best way to go. In some instances, they actually are quite expensive and not good to transplant things. And you will only learn if it's better to transplant it out or do it from direct seed by experimenting and trying it. Hey, put some in from transplants right next to them, try to direct seed some, see which ones do better. In the case of tomatoes, right, I have some tomatoes sprouting up just from my compost pile and compost and whatnot that I've composted. And sometimes those plants do actually quite well, but also, you know, sometimes the transplants do quite well. So I kind of like to have a balance of those. And in gardening and in life, I want you guys never to think in terms of right, wrong, good, bad. Transplants, they're always the way to go, or transplants, they're always bad, or, you know, starting from seed is always bad, or it's always good. It's never always anything, always bad or always good. It always just depends on the situation. So, you know, you could learn from other gardeners and people doing it in your specific area, because every specific area is a little bit different in the region, although there are some basic standards. You know, a lot of the farmers that I've met and ran into, you know, in most cases, they like to put things in as a transplant because they get a lot higher level of success when they do that. So while many of my primary crops are put in by transplants, I also have plenty of seeds germinating in the garden to give me even more food. And I enjoy these when they come, and when they are edible crops, if they can benefit me, feed me, and make me healthier. So what I like to do in this part of the episode is actually share with you guys some of the plants that I start in my garden from seed, whether that's me taking seeds and broadcasting them around, or whether that's from seeds being dormant in the ground and just coming back year after year. You know, if you want an easy garden, find some of the seeds that I'll be sharing with you guys in this part of the episode and broadcast them and put them out, because likely if your climate's like mine, they're just gonna grow like gangbusters.
Let's take you guys on a little bit of a walking tour. So as you guys can see over on this side, I have all my peppers. I finally got them staked up. But actually in between all the peppers, I have lots of other food growing. And this is as a living mulch to cover the ground so the sun doesn't hit the ground. They hit mostly green leaves that causes photosynthesis, that causes the plants to send down exudates into the soil. On the purslane roots, that'll feed the microbes, get them happier. And also I'm growing rich, delicious purslane, high in omega-3 fatty acids, another really rich and valuable leafy green you guys should be eating. And it's only going to be here for about another month or so. Then when it basically is no longer living because the weather gets too hot, I'm basically going to mulch probably with some coconut coir. So yeah, the purslane grows super good, super well. And then over here, let me show you guys some of the ones that have actually direct seeded. So you guys can see all these nice, beautiful reddish green plants right here. I'll do a close up right on this guy right here. This is known as water pepper. So I grew water pepper once, and now the water pepper just comes up on its own. I forget if I like shook seeds out over here. I probably did. That's why we have them in nice large clumps. But you know, they grew on their own at the proper time, and they're huge. But at the same time, if you did the Malabar spinach, you know, they wouldn't have came up. Likewise, you know, over here, or right down below, if you guys could see these guys, those of you guys have been watching me for a while, you guys know what this is. This is the Ashitaba. I love the Ashitaba, and everybody asks me, John, how do you germinate the Ashitaba? And honestly, I don't know, because I don't germinate Ashitaba. I let nature do it for me, right? Whether the plants drop the seeds in the ground, and then the seeds sprout on their own when the weather and temperature's right, or in this case, I took seeds, and I just sprinkled them on the ground, maybe covered them maybe a little bit, maybe hardly nothing at all. And then they just came up whenever they wanted to. And so, you know, I think they germinated in the springtime when the weather got a little bit warmer. If I was them, I would have probably sprouted a little bit earlier. But this is when they wanted to do it. And now I'm going to have, hopefully, a pretty good Nevada-grown Ashitaba. That's me heat tolerant. We will see what happens. Let's see. Let's go ahead and continue around and see what else we could find that germinates on its own in my garden. So another seed that germinates quite easily in my garden is not the Canna adalis, which is grown above, but right down below I seeded in the same pots some Egyptian spinach. So this Egyptian spinach I basically seeded when I put these Canna pots together because I wanted to grow food underneath them, and they came up in due time. You know, they are getting kind of big now, but I would have liked to maybe put these in as transplants when the plants were a lot bigger. I have seen they're going to do better. This to me is a bit late. I mean, they are still a bit small, though they will handle the heat even if they are small. But they, once again, they start growing pretty, slow at first, and then they're going to take off faster later. All right, on to the other side of my garden. Oh, and then another thing that sells seeds really easily. You guys can see I grew wild arugula over in this pot right here, then the seeds dropped, and then you could see in my onion bed, they're just coming up, and even in the cracks down below, the wild arugula is coming up, and yeah, arugula usually comes up pretty good. Oh, and then another one that comes up pretty good usually, not super good, but this guy right here, you guys, those are the seed pods, and that's the red vein sorrel that usually comes up, but what comes up the best of anything is right in this bed. If you guys could see that, that's literally one whole bed. And then I even got more because I got part of the bed over there is being taken over and part of the bed over here is being taken over. This is actually the Breton shiso. So it's green on the top, and on the underside of the leaves, it's nice purple pigmented anthocyanins. And this guy just totally pops out and sprouts at the right time and dominates. So yeah, you definitely want to grow the Breton shiso or other shisos if you're in a hot climate. They just love it so much.
All right, so that brings us to the end of today's episode. And basically what'd you learn? You learned that, you know, you might want to start from transplants, especially if some things are really slow to grow and they never really have performed well for you. I mean, if I just had the seedling Malabar spinaches, I mean, I'd get a little bit this year, but because I got them transplanted in early and the plants were already established, they're gonna do a lot better. Same thing with all the peppers you guys see over here. These were transplanted in, actually, most of these guys were transplanted in from gallons. Some of them were transplanted in from 4-inchers. and they're doing a lot better than if I tried to start out with, you know, direct seeding some peppers. Although I do have a direct seed actually all the way down at the end. I gotta take a look and see how it's doing. But yeah, I think by putting plants in, if you could get them up to size in another location in a greenhouse indoors with proper lighting so they're not like leggy, you know, I think you're gonna have much better harvest and return on your investment for most crops. Although that being said, some plants are weedy and they're gonna do fine by direct seeding. So I guess in the end, I want you guys to experiment, do both ways and see which one works better for you, right? And you're just gonna learn as you grow. And that's what I like to tell people. And so yeah, this is just something I've learned, the Malabar spinach. Gotta start out with transplants, man. Don't direct seed it unless you start it really early. And I never got my stuff together to start them like in January when I really should be. So anyways, if you guys enjoyed this short format video, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,300 episodes at this time. Teach you guys all aspects on how you guys could grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.